And welcome back to Equal Time for Free Thought. I'm Barry Seidman. During this rather provocative election cycle, I found myself in a different sort of conversation with friends and colleagues than in most recent years. The rise of Donald Trump is both something not surprising and more than a little frightening. It's a different sort of conversation, however, as Trump stands outside what many consider to be establishment politics. The same, of course, can be said for progressive Bernie Sanders, who has breathed new life into the term socialism, even if socialists don't actually acknowledge him as such. Still, the stark differences between Sanders and Hillary Clinton are clear enough for everyone to see. Yet a significant number of liberals and progressives have voted in favor of the neoliberal with ties to corporate America and the military-industrial complex. And then there's the debates among progressives and leftists, which range from those who would like to see Sanders in the White House but are willing to vote for Hillary Clinton in the ultimate lesser of two evils move, to those who don't think it's worth voting at all. On Equal Time, we haven't so much discussed electoral politics, but have instead looked underneath the chaos at the rotting foundation below. Whether discussing racism and whiteness with Tim Wise and Robin DiAngelo, reviewing the natural and social scientific examinations of American society, or discussing more directly the relationship between capitalism and what results from it on the physical and psychological lives of each one of us, we have tried to go deeper than the symptoms of our current state of the nation and address the disease or diseases. Along the way, we have tried to remain hopeful that somehow our knowledge of all this and the growing discontent in the country could lead us towards progressive social change. But not everyone is convinced that this is possible. A few of our previous guests, including Chris Hedges and today's guest, Morris Berman, are looking at America and preparing her epitaph. While Hedges has a rather Hobbesian take on human nature in general, Morris might yet see a possible outcome for humanity, only probably not in the United States. Today, as we head into the 4th of July holiday, we will speak to Professor Berman and see if we can pull some of these things together. Morris Berman is an American historian and social critic. Born in Rochester, New York, going on to earn his BA in mathematics at Cornell University in 1966 and his PhD in the history of science at Johns Hopkins University in 1972, Berman has held visiting endowed chairs at Concord College in San Antonio, the University of New Mexico, and Weber State University. From 1982 to 1988, he was the Lansdowne Professor in the History of Science at the University of Victoria, British Columbia. Berman won the Rollo May Center Grant for Humanistic Studies in 1992 and the Neil Postman Award for Career Achievement in Public Intellectual Activity from the Media Ecology Association in 2013. He is author of a trilogy on the evolution of human consciousness, The Reenchantment of the World, Coming to Our Senses, and Wandering God. The first of these, The Reenchantment of the World, became a bestseller. In 2000, the first of his trilogy on American Empire and Culture, Twilight of American Culture, was named a quote-unquote notable book by the New York Times Book Review. Berman relocated to Mexico in 2006 and for a couple of years was a visiting professor at the Tecnológico de Monterrey, pardon me if I'm pronouncing that wrong, in Mexico City. Currently, he has a short novel out called The Man Without Qualities.
Welcome, Morris, to Equal Time for Free Thought.
Thanks for the invitation, Barry. I appreciate it.
I know we probably shouldn't expect to move linearly throughout your work, at least the parts of it which meet the needs of this particular program, but I'll try to do that to begin with at least and see where we go from there. I want to address your two trilogies first and then wrap up with the new novel. The first trilogy on alternative forms of consciousness and spirituality ends with Wandering God, that's book three of the trilogy, as to what I had a chance to look through. Before I ask about this book specifically, can you tell us why you wrote this trilogy and what your overall message or messages were?
You know, I think in the case of all my books, it wasn't a case of sitting down and saying, now I'd like to write a book on this particular topic. It's that circumstances in my life grabbed me, and the topic became clear. It was emerged from a visceral place. It didn't emerge from a headspace. In the case of the first of the trilogy, actually the only bestseller I've ever had, it was called The Reenchantment of the World, and, you know, it's still in print, still going strong. And in that case, it was a series of circumstances that in the 60s I was pursuing a doctorate at Johns Hopkins in History of Science, and increasingly asking questions about the validity of the epistemological basis of science. It was called the sociology of knowledge. That was the name of that field, and I was pursuing that. And I remember, you know, I was a grad student. I remember I was at a party that some people in the department had thrown. I was talking to another grad student, and suddenly I blurted out, what if it turned out that the mechanical philosophy of the 17th century was nothing more than an ideology? And he stared at me with these wide eyes, and he said, the hair on the back of my neck just stood up.
Paradigm-shifting thought there.
Yeah. I mean, I felt the same thing, and I just blurted this out, you know? And that was what I pursued, and, you know, I say that it was the only bestseller I ever had, and I think there are a number of reasons for that, but one of those reasons is that the central point of the book was extremely controversial, and it was that there was no way to really demonstrate that modern science had any epistemological superiority to its magical antecedents, like alchemy and astrology and witchcraft and numerology and so on. And once you say that, I mean, man, the game is wide open. You know? I mean, what is reality finally, you know? And that was what I pursued. And, you know, I mean, I'd have to say today that, you know, in terms of the external world, modern science is very good at describing what's there. But it fails with regard to the inner world, and it also fails in a larger sense, you know, a sense that Pope Francis was talking about when he was here in Mexico, that's where I live, you know, a while ago. He said, we have to pay attention to traditional cultures and their sense of the interconnectedness of everything. Well, modern science doesn't believe in the interconnectedness of everything, and in that sense, previous systems of thought, like magical systems of Western Europe, were superior. You know, I mean, they had a grip on the fact of the interrelatedness of all life.
Well, that was the Eastern philosophies, too, like Buddhism.
Right. So as a result, the timing was very good because it was published in 1981, and a whole number of, well, millions of people in Europe and the United States were disillusioned with science, not because, you know, it produced the atomic bomb and it could be used for evil and technology and all that. That was an old argument that had been had a long time ago. It was because they were disillusioned that it didn't really grasp reality in its totality. It just pretended to do so, but that it failed in significant ways. And that was a very, very attractive idea at that time. And so the book, you know, I mean, you don't sit down and say, now I'm going to write a bestseller. It doesn't work that way. It happened, and it happened because, you know, I hit a major cultural nerve, something people, you know, had suspected for a long time, that this way of life was making us ill, which I believe it is.
There are some people in the science world that is also questioning the reductionism. Not questioning, but saying that we need to move past that because there is a sense of interconnectedness, at least in the social sciences, maybe not so much in the hard sciences because that's not necessarily what physics deals with or chemistry or even biology. But there have been people like Carl Sagan and others who have said, who have tried to bridge those gaps. But it's not easy, and because the culture we live in, it makes it even more difficult. Our show, Equal Time for Free Thought, is a secular, humanistic, atheistic program where we try to build on scientific naturalist foundation, the philosophy of science, not necessarily, you know, anything specific. But your work does overlap with some of this philosophy, but for the series, you're not talking about the naturalist, atheist perspective, I'm gathering. So, or is that too narrow a way to describe your perspective? Because it seems like it's...
Pinned to the wall, I would call myself a sacred humanist rather than a secular humanist.
I haven't heard that one before. Okay.
Yeah, or sometimes I say to people, I'm a mystical atheist. I'm no longer convinced for a long time that the world just consists of material stuff. The picture is a lot more complicated than that. And that doesn't mean that we have to become a collection of Oprah-istic New Age morons. You know, that's the step that I think a lot of people fell into, you know, that the mind is everything and matter is nothing and so on and so forth. Being a sacred humanist means that you're attuned to a larger reality than merely the material world, whatever that might mean.
Just to clarify for our audiences who may have never heard this, I'm sure, haven't heard that phrase before, let me just ask for myself as well. You're not rejecting a naturalistic view on some levels of science or materialistic view.
Not at all.
And you're also not supporting, you know, what we call New Age, you know, aliens have landed, you know, ESP, paranormalism, all that stuff. And you're not necessarily on the metaphysical level supporting, I don't think, supernaturalism.
No, I'm not interested in any of that. The book that followed Reenchantment, Coming to Our Senses, talks about altered states of consciousness, but basically finally roots them in human biology, in our physiology, and the ability of the body to do certain things and therefore create certain types of perceptions, you know. So I don't believe that there are UFOs flying around or, you know, that if you just think in a certain way, you can change reality. I mean, all that, you know, Oprah show kind of stuff, that's not my bag.
That's really interesting because it seems to be, you know, sort of people try to categorize themselves or other people into one of those three categories. You're either a theist, you know, in a supernatural God sense, or you're a New Age, you know, spiritualist or whatever they call themselves, or you're this atheist naturalist, you know, the Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris's of the world, and you're not talking about the first two at all, and you are mixing the naturalist view with something else.
I mean, the Dawkins-Harris worldview is far too narrow. It's far too narrow.
So, well, let me go a little further. We discussed consciousness, and that's the term being used throughout the book trilogy, in various ways throughout our show, and do refer to social scientists we speak of, like you have, like Maslow and others who have discussed human nature and those questions from a social science perspective. We've had philosophers and neuroscientists occasionally to talk about consciousness, but my guess is that that's not what went through your mind when writing these books. Just to sort of wrap up this section of our discussion before we move on, only because also WBAI has a lot of programming and listeners who are in the New Age envelope, so to speak, not us, but they are. And so how are you using the word consciousness? And even how are you using the word God in the sense of the term wandering God when you wrote the final book of the trilogy?
I suppose, the capstone of the whole thing, wandering God, that we had a certain consciousness that was associated with hunter-gatherer society and with movement, because hunter-gatherers move. They're not sedentary.
Right.
And that is a consciousness that I described as horizontal. It's a peripheral consciousness, and it's a kind of alertness to the world as it is. And that's what I believe shows up on the caves of Lascaux, let's say, where you see is pictures of animals, you know, because that was the environment, in a kind of vibrant and immediate way. And that's what animism really is. It's not, for the hunter-gatherers anyway, it's not some woo-woo kind of thing. It's the immediate vibrancy of the surrounding world. And frankly, that consciousness is open to all of us. I mean, I remember once describing sitting in my patio and watching a very, very brilliantly multicolored beetle making its way along the edge of a plant, you know, a potted plant I had, and how fascinated I was by the immediacy and the reality of that. That's the hunter-gatherer perception or the hunter-gatherer consciousness, and that's what I call horizontal. The other one, vertical, is associated with trance phenomena, and it actually isn't as old as we think. I mean, shamanism, what I show in Wandering God, only goes back to about 2000 BC, something like that. And that is that's rather than an immanent perception, which is the hunter-gatherer perception, it's a transcendent perception. And, of course, it's the basis of most religions, that reality is somewhere else. Now, the legacy of that I discuss in Wandering God, the legacy of the horizontal type of consciousness shows up in Buddhism, for example, which is not really a religion, oddly enough. The idea is to see reality as it is. That's what Satori is, or Kensho. That's the immediate perception of life as it is. It's purely horizontal. And the major philosopher in the 20th century who brought back that horizontal consciousness was Wittgenstein, and I spend a whole chapter on the insight that he really had, because he was torn between the two. The first part of his life was a mystical kind of Platonic understanding of the world that was transcendent, and then he wrote the Tractatus and ended by saying, you know, of what we cannot speak, we must be silent, a mystical kind of vision, and then gave it up. I mean, he went, became a school teacher in the provinces, you know, of Austria, and when he came back to teach at Cambridge, everything was immediately grounded. Examples that he would give to his classes of what he's talking about came out of things like American detective novels. I mean, that's how immediate and grounded and horizontal he became. So he was caught between these two perceptions. So I'm talking about consciousness, I mean, in that sense of how the world is experienced and perceived.
When I was reading those sections, horizontalism and verticalism, I understood how you were using it in this sense, obviously. And I also gravitated to the differentiation you made between hunter-gatherers, specifically, I guess, nomadic hunter-gatherers, which was the bulk, 98% of our existence on the planet, versus the last, you know, 2%, which was more vertical, you know, with religion, you're saying it. But I'm also thinking, do you tie this into when we talk about horizontalism and verticalism politically, such as nomadic hunter-gatherers were horizontal in the sense of how they developed their societies, you know, like a direct democracy kind of thing, even though that wasn't that sophisticated, of course, versus the vertical, which are about, you know, dominance-based hierarchies, top-down pyramids and stuff like that, which has dramatically changed, you know, since the agricultural revolution, how we deal with each other, and that's taken us to this point that we're in now, which is so lovely. Do you see an overlap between horizontalism and verticalism, the way you discuss in the book, as far as like metaphysically or spiritually, with the political and how we organize society, or are they two different things in your mind?
No, I think they're all of a piece, and there's a, I think it's the second chapter. It's been so long since I looked at the book, but I think it's the second chapter, but that is about the origins of social inequality.
Right.
And that, you know, and that basically these modes of perception get translated into political regimes. And so you're right. I mean, we now have almost in every, you know, country, you know, this ruling elite. Let's say that the people that do the administration, and this goes back 10,000 years, the people that do the administration want to be especially rewarded for their work in this area. And they get it because they're in charge.
Right.
And so what you have over time is an increasingly sharp pyramid. The recent, I mean, it just happened, the Brexit vote and
right.
the Trump popularity are both expressions of people saying, we hate you guys. We hate you. You have no right to manipulate our lives like this. And I understand that. I mean, I don't think it's an irrational response. I think it's a very rational response. So the type of thing that we have is that hunter-gatherer anthropology is kind of complex because, for example, Australia doesn't follow the dominant pattern. It's exceptional in hunter-gatherer societies. But if we leave Australia out, the others had relative gender and social equality.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that is because you didn't have storage. Once you start having storage, then somebody's got to administer and distribute the goods, you know, and control those goods. And that and population pressure and a number of other factors led to this vertical arrangement that is metaphysical, a verticality of consciousness, and also a verticality of politics. So,
right, so the individual, certain individuals become the god of their culture, so to speak.
Yeah, and most of our experience on the planet, you know, if Homo sapiens goes back at least 100,000 years, most of our experience on the planet has been horizontal. And then
right.
it got pasted over, like 10,000 years ago, by this vertical arrangement. And that, to me, accounts for a lot of the kind of sickness that pervades society. In other words, if this sort of artificial verticality got pasted on a horizontal way of life that went back many millennia, then
right.
of course the individual is going to be constantly in revolt or unhappy with the surrounding way of life and the politics involved. Too bad that Sigmund Freud was just talking about sex in his work, especially
right.
something like Civilization and Its Discontents, because the discontent is not just over repressed sexuality, it's over repressed everything.
And especially in this society, in American society, where this rugged, individualistic, atomized extreme, where it's actually a virtue to be this single entity, disconnected from everything else and everybody else.
Yeah, I mean, on a worldwide scale, historically and both contemporaneously, I think we're the sickest society that ever lived.
I've shown your work in discussing with friends leading up to this program, because I'm just becoming familiar with your work over the last few months. And the response is coming back from everybody, not just liberals, and I don't really communicate with a whole lot with conservatives anymore, or they don't want to with me, but even people from the left, they consider what you're writing, in this case and in the other trilogy we'll get to, is rather pessimistic. So along those lines, I've been thinking, is it possible to get back to our humanity, so to speak, to get back to horizontalism, without going back to the nomadic hunter-gatherer, because that's what people always automatically say. Oh, then you want to go back to living in the forest. No, that's not what I mean. Because we do have the science and technology to be able to connect the whole planet in a healthy way, not in this capitalistic way that we do now, that would make it easier for us to have horizontalism globally, because there's always ways that this group over here can communicate with that group over there when we need to do things that are more global rather than local. But do you think there's a chance we can get there, at least without, you know, a great disaster or a great die-off of our species, which it seems like we're heading to?
People have said to me, oh, then wandering out is about how we should return to hunter-gatherer society. And
right.
I say, good luck with that, you know. I don't think it's going to happen. But what I do say in the last chapter, I make suggestions about how elements of that society, how elements of horizontality could be introduced into our culture in various ways. But right now, I mean, if that happens, I think it would be among small decentralized groups. I mean,
right.
I don't see it as something that would encompass the whole planet. And the only way that could happen, I think, is an apocalypse. There would have to be a massive kind of destruction and reduction in population.
I think we discussed this very briefly on email preparing for the show. Would you also consider certain forms of anarchism, which is sort of, I guess, small enclaves? It's, again, it's radical decentralization, I guess. It would have to get to like a post-scarcity society, of course, in order to do that.
Yeah, and I think we're heading to that. I mean, capitalism can't last a century out. It just can't last out the 21st century. It's in a process of progressive disintegration, and we're going to be somewhere. I mean, by the time I die, which I hope will be around mid-century, we're going to be in a very different place, you know, and certainly after my death. I mean, it's going to look very different. But the trouble with small enclaves, I mean, there is no perfect society and there's, you know, utopia. And the problem
right.
with small enclaves is that they can lend themselves to a kind of charismatic figure taking
mm-hmm.
charge, which is definitely a vertical model.
We need more than a structural change. We need a new common sense, as somebody once referred it to, the way we think about ourselves and each other.
Just want to say, make
yeah,
one commentary about the issue of pessimistic. You know, I'm frequently accused of that, but my usual response, which is, you know, a common one, is no, I'm being realistic. One of my favorite lines in philosophy is from Kant, from the crooked timber of humanity, no straight thing was ever made. And I think we need to keep that in mind, that human beings are not perfect, that there will be no utopia, but what we are talking about is better versus worse. And
mm-hmm.
what I'm trying to do in my life work now, I mean, the novel was the 13th book I wrote. What I've been trying to do in my life work is to say, here, this is better. This is what better looks like.
Yeah, and that's very important, because it is true that a lot of people who whose job it is, whose mission it is to show what the problems are. And you've done that as well, particularly with your failed America trilogy. But often other people don't provide, okay, here's an alternative or here's several alternatives and let's come up with other alternatives together kind of thing. And usually they just kind of end with like a chapter of what might be an alternative and then it's the book's ended. I'm happy that you and some others are taking it in that direction, because when I criticize what's going on in the world, and when I posted essays of yours on Facebook, for instance, and had people discuss it, that's what I usually hear, is all you guys are tearing things down. What are you building up in its place? And then I present that to them. The only problem is often, unless they're already there mentally, they just look at what I'm presenting or what you're presenting as utopian, as unrealistic.
Yeah. Well, the last article I wrote, which actually was published in Spanish in a journal in Mexico City, but is on my blog. I haven't published it in English yet, but it's posted on my blog, is called Dual Process, The Only Game in Town. And that is about an argument as capitalism disintegrates, there is a concomitant emergence of alternatives, alternative energy, alternative currency, alternative lifestyles, and so on, that is growing and that will eventually replace it, which is how capitalism replaced feudalism. These are things that take time.
This is WBAI New York, 99.5 FM, streaming at WBAI.org. You have been listening to a conversation with cultural historian and social critic Morris Berman on a variety of topics, including consciousness, American empire, and what he's called sacred humanism. And now, back to the interview.
I think a good possible segue from this trilogy to the American Empire trilogy is to ask this question. Apropos to our current electoral situation, you mentioned it briefly with Trump, and now we have this new thing going on in England. You began book three of the trilogy, Wandering God, with your experience while at a rally for Eugene McCarthy back in 68. And you discuss what Americans look for in their leaders, or perhaps I should say rulers. You do this elsewhere in the book when discussing the Jimmy Carter versus Ronald Reagan election cycle and how we moved from the end of Keynesian social democracy, sort of. We never quite got as far as Scandinavia did with that, but to this neoliberal conservative model that we've had since. And we see this playing out again today with the Hillary Clinton versus Trump and Bernie Sanders attempt to move the Democrats back a little bit to the left. Taking what you have written in that trilogy into the present time, how do you see what's going on right now?
Well, both Brexit and Trump are expressions of rage on the part of an electorate that knows on some level that neoliberal capitalism is a con game in which they're going to lose. The basic setup is that a few people will make it to the top and the rest of us will have to be satisfied with the crumbs and be a kind of service society for those rich people. I think there's a generalized awareness that, it's covered with a patina of talk about freedom and democracy, but that's just all talk. That has no basic reality if the people that are running for office are bought and paid for by corporations, and that the differences between the candidates are Tweedledee and Tweedledum. So Right. There's an understanding, I think, a kind of visceral understanding on the part of, a lot of Brits and a lot of Americans that this system is not for you. It's not designed for you. It's not going to help you. It's a system for the rich, by the rich, and of the rich, and you will always remain struggling at the bottom. This understanding manifested itself in the Brexit vote, certainly, and now the resignation of Cameron, and the remarkable high polling numbers of Donald Trump, to the point that he's basically wrecked the Republican Party, and he will be the nominee. And I don't think, myself, just a guess, I think Hillary will defeat him, but even that he could come this close is quite amazing, and it says something very important about what's going on in the country.
Why do you think, there's lots of answers for this, but I'm curious in your perspective, of course. Why do you think people who are recognizing this across the board in this country, it's a little different in England, gravitated towards Donald Trump, not just former Republicans, but and see Trump, who was really a product of neoliberalism, a product of the 1%, rather than more strongly to Bernie Sanders, who is perhaps, even though he's still within the capitalist hegemony, perhaps a little more rational philosophy to try to have some kind of social democracy, some kind of Keynesian capitalism, rein in neoliberalism to some degree. There is some in the Bernie Sanders movement, the Feel the Burn movement, there has been some of that as well, but it seems very different there than it does with Trump. And Trump has gotten a lot further. And maybe because there is no Hillary Clinton in the Republican Party since Jeb Bush dropped out long ago. Why would people gravitate, do you think, to Trump rather than Sanders?
I mean, it's an important question. And also, I mean, obviously, there are a number of factors like fascist nativism, you know, and white supremacy and stuff like that that's operating in Trump's case. But I have to say that I regarded both Trump and Bernie as very, very similar in the following sense. They were truly, are truly authentic. They are saying what they really believe, and they don't care whether you like it or not. It's very different things they're saying. But they are saying, they're speaking from the heart, and they're speaking authentically. And it's kind of amusing to me because when I wrote the novel, The Man Without Qualities, I mean, I wrote that last October, and at that time, I must have been picking up the zeitgeist because the book is about the politics of authenticity and how that plays out on the American scene. And I must have been picking something up because at that time, Bernie's and Trump's numbers weren't that high. Nobody knew how significant they were. But they proved to be very significant, and I think a factor in that is they speak with an authentic voice. Hillary Clinton doesn't speak with an authentic voice. She speaks with a scripted voice. She has Botox in her face. And she has Botox inside her head. And she's a plastic person whose answers are predictable. She knows what to say the right thing, and so on. And so I think accounted for great popularity of both Bernie and Donald Trump in that people understood that they were breaking ranks. They, you know, it wasn't about the party line. It was truly saying, this is what I feel and this is what needs to happen, even though those visions are very different. The other thing as far as Bernie goes is you have to ask yourself why he lost. And there's a lot of talk about how it was rigged and superdelegates and all that. And that's true, but except the bottom line here is that Hillary got the votes. There's no question about that. She got the votes. And why was that the case and where did she get the votes? Bernie won in small white states. That was his constituency. Those were people who were thoughtful and reflective and said, well, this guy's a kind of modified FDR. You know, that's what he's selling and seems pretty good to me. It would be a better country if, as you say, we took the horns out of the neoliberal program, you know. So it's still capitalism, but it's a gentler form of it. And that's what FDR did. I mean, that's exactly what he did. And so Bernie is following in that path. This is no great socialist radical. This is just an FDR type, and it makes sense. The states that Hillary won were large ones with large minority populations. And those minority populations are not really interested in what Bernie's talking about. What they're interested in is the American dream. This is especially true of black people and Hispanics, also true of Asian people, that basically the American dream is alive and well for them. It's a very foolish perception, I think, but they believe it. And what Hillary offers is the continuation of that dream, not the modification of it that Bernie offers. So when those populations look at Bernie, they feel he has nothing to offer them. Now, when I say it's a foolish perception, I mean that the whole ideology of economic expansion and progress finally results in savagery, and that there's no hope in that direction, and we need to look at that. But it's alive and well. Many years ago, I was a tutor in the inner city in Washington, D.C. The school was 100% black. The girls were fairly smart, I have to say. They understood what they were up against. The boys didn't have a clue. They were all going to be basketball players or hip-hop artists, and they were going to make millions. And if I sat down with them and I said, you know, right now, if a computer selected randomly a black male between 18 and 24 in the United States, the odds are 200 times more likely that that person is in jail than in college. Now, what do you think that means for your life? They couldn't hear that. Mm-hmm. In fact, what they were going to do, probably, was become drug dealers and then wind up in jail. That was probably the most likely path, you know. And so that's the American dream for them, to win the brass ring, to be 50 Cent or Michael Jordan. And, man, then you've got it, you know. And they really believe, every one of them believed that they could do that, even though, you know, statistically, it didn't look very likely. And you walk around New York City, Barry, and on every street corner, there's a small Korean salad bar. Mm-hmm. You know, these little, you know, that's the immigrant dream. You come to the United States, you're a Korean or whatever, you set up a little salad bar, and you work 60 hours a week, and you know what, at the end of your life, you can retire with a little nest egg. That's the American dream, and that's very much a non-white kind of dream. I mean, the whites have it as well, of course, but it's very much an immigrant type of, or minority group type of dream. Those were the states that Hillary won because that's what she's offering. And yeah, Bernie wasn't offering that.
The legacy of racism as far as African-American community and other problems we've had in our society with nativism that leads to the immigration, hatred against immigrants and so on and so forth, that's been around a lot longer than Donald Trump's been around. These groups think, okay, Euro-American people already did this. They already made it. They already had their rugged individualism and their self-made man dream already have made them into successes in the American dream, regardless of what backlash is happening now. But they yet haven't, so now it's their turn. They should be able to do the same thing because they see the inequality. And inequality is still pretty much, you know, even though it's the 1% and it's only a handful of people, it's still perceived and probably is in many ways still perceived on color lines and on, you know, white male versus everybody else. I can see what you're saying is why this is still the psychology of people who have been suffering at the hands of the very system that they're now still supporting because they want a piece of the pie.
Yeah, I understand that. It's just that there's really no future in that for the United States. And, I mean, just in terms of preserving ourselves, we would be much better off walking, you know, down the Bernie Sanders path. But, you know, that wasn't going to happen. And it certainly wasn't going to happen among minority groups that voted heavily, very heavily, for Hillary, because she represents the continuation of that dream and not the modification of that dream.
Right, right. So moving a little bit to your second trilogy, you say something that I never thought of in this perspective, just one of those things that's obvious that just never crossed my mind. America started out as a mess, if one considers genocide and chattel slavery a mess, of course. And as you put it, we began less as a country and more as a business opportunity. I'm not sure if those are the exact words you used, but it struck me, because this was a capitalist experiment, the United States. It wasn't building another country in a traditional sense. And that we might have been a doomed republic from the get-go then. So what does our origins tell us about where we are today? Was this something bound to happen, where we've gotten to this point now where everything is sort of collapsing around us, not just capitalism, but also our civil society?
Well, the popularity of Trump and the possibility of Trump actually entering the White House next January are, as far as I'm concerned, a complete vindication of the argument I make in why America failed. Because I say that, you know, from the 1580s, the literature that floated around England about why you should go to the colonies or develop colonies was read like contemporary real estate brochures. Mm-hmm. Come over, make a killing.
Literally.
The entrepreneurial section of the British middle class was what came over. From that point, late 16th century on, you had a hustling society that just became increasingly hustling, more and more and more, until finally, you know, you have a quantum leap with Ronald Reagan, probably one of the sickest people that ever existed on the planet, and, you know, promoting this very sick way of life, and then finally, the ultimate hustler. What is Donald Trump besides a cutthroat businessman? You know, I mean, that's his whole thing. And that he would become president is a complete vindication of what I've been saying. If you do this for 400 years, who do you think finally is going to show up in the White House except people like Reagan and Trump? Of course that's what's going to happen. They represent the ideals, I use that word in quotes, the ideals of the American continent for 400 years.
We mentioned, you know, what Bernie Sanders was offering, and you said it's not going to happen, or it's very unlikely to happen. Do you think it's even desirable, even if it was possible, that we could remake social democracy here or in other parts of Europe in any form? Or if not, which I'm gathering is your opinion, what can we do, if not in the United States? Because I think you're pretty direct saying that you're not sure anything taking us in a forward progressive direction is going to work, at least at this time, especially if Donald Trump or if Hillary Clinton get into the White House, that maybe it will have to happen in Europe or in some quote-unquote third-world country. Do you think there's a chance we or Western society or the world in some way could move back to or direct ourselves towards a more humanistic capitalism, or we have to really create something from whole cloth?
Well, you know, Western Europe is a capitalist consumer society, but, you know, the modifications that are involved are quite significant. If you take a look at Michael Moore's latest film, Where to Invade Next, you mm-hmm. know, I mean, it's a brilliant idea that he had. It's a brilliant conceit that you go from one country to another and you show, you know, in terms of medicine, education, prison systems, and so on, that there is such a thing as enlightened attitudes, that you can modify the system quite significantly. And what emerged for me from that film was how cruel America is, just how violent, how cruel it is as a country, and that you have such differences, not only Western Europe, but especially Scandinavia, enormous differences. So there's a lot of wide latitude possible within capitalism. It will not happen here. It will not happen here. The constellation of infinite expansion and rugged individualism and, you know, the belief that America is the greatest and the notion of my ship will finally come in. You know, John Steinbeck once said the reason socialism never took root in the United States is that all the poor believe that they're temporarily embarrassed millionaires. They're just waiting for the ship to come in. And that's the vote for Hillary among minority populations. You know, mm-hmm. I'm going to be a hip-hop artist. I'm going to make it. Granted, statistically it's not likely, but I'm going to be the exception. Well, if everybody's going to be the exception, you've got Garrison Keillor's line about, you know, all the children are above average. <You know? laughs> Right. It doesn't really work that way. So I think that to answer your question, I think that there are possibilities elsewhere, especially mm-hmm. going back to that article I wrote on dual process. You have Spain, for example. I read this 2 or 3 years ago. There are probably more experiments today, but as of 2 or 3 years ago, Spain had 325 separate experiments in alternative currency. Things like alternative currency, alternative energy, alternative ways of life, that's the second part of dual process, that as capitalism collapses, you have something emerging, a structure that's emerging that's going to replace it. But I don't think it's going to happen in the United States. I think the United States is finally screwed. There's no happy outcome that I can see. I mean, it's amazing to me that people believed that Bernie even had a chance. You know, I mean,
although it is interesting that he got as many people to vote for him as he did.
Right, but right.
The other comparison you make is with where you live now in Mexico, and you talk about the authenticness of with all the problems in your new country, with all the problems, a lot of them caused from neoliberalism from the United States and elsewhere. You speak about a more horizontalist humanity than what we have in Western society. And then you also contrast that, though, I think, not directly, but you contrast what you see in Mexico with what you saw in the antebellum South. And I mentioned that to a friend, and I said, but for the slavery, Morris Berman thinks the antebellum South was something positive, a positive moment in our history. the reaction I got, you know, was sort of like stunned silence for a second, and then it was like, oh yeah, that little thing called slavery, just, you know, but for that.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, I got vilified and people went insane over, oh, well, he's racist and he's pro-slavery and all that sort of thing. And this comes out, I mean, there are various reasons for that, and one of that is an insistence I have that I've made for many years that Americans are not very bright. Compared with other countries, they're just not that intelligent. And one thing that they can't grasp is nuance. Things are black and white for Americans. They're Manichaean. It's all or nothing, good or evil. And the thing is that in no way does that chapter, it's chapter 4 of Why America Failed, in no way does it condone slavery. And I say at several points that the Civil War had to be fought to root it out. I mean, I make that explicit. And that didn't satisfy the critics. In fact, my argument is not original with me. It's taken from people, great historians, people that are 100 rungs above me in talent, like Eugene Genovese or C. Van Woodward, who were historians of the American South, and who showed what a vibrant culture it really was and how laid back it was. And that was the point that I was trying to make, that there's a paradox there. It was laid back because it rested on a slave economy. Well, you know, that's kind of ugly, but there you have it. It was, you know, a very relaxed and genteel society. Gone with the Wind is not totally mythology. There's some truth to it. I mean, the paradox is that a society that had really beautiful aspects to it rested on an economy that was ugly in the extreme. History isn't neat and it isn't clean. It doesn't present itself in categories that may be acceptable to us or make us happy. It's quite messy. And this is what I tried to talk about there. But Americans aren't interested in messy, complex, or anything that's nuanced. They're just not that bright. And they can't read this and say, wow, what a remarkable paradox that this genteel, relaxed, horizontal, whatever, society rested upon a very, very cruel institution. For them, that's impossible. But in fact, those are the facts.
If people could get to that point, I mean, I tend to agree with you about the general American populace, which is interesting because most of us who suffer the descendants of slaves, most of us have come from other countries which weren't like we are here, which weren't as unnuanced or ignorant or stupid, as you very bluntly put it. But yet they become so once they're here. Maybe it's the economy, maybe it's the sociopathic elements of society, it's capitalism or our form of capitalism or whatever it is, the American dream. But once here, though, that seems to be the case amongst a lot of people. But if they were able, if people were able to make that forward move and understand that paradox, that kind of leads to what we were saying earlier, that if the economy was such, if we develop an economy such that it wasn't cruel like slavery or cruel like wage slavery, like capitalism, but something else, if that's what we required in order to have a society like the antebellum South, a genteel, horizontalist sort of society, now we can do that. We can get post-capitalism. We can get to something like that. So it wouldn't be such a paradox. We actually can have our cake and eat it too. But if they can't get even to that point, like you say, it's kind of useless and rather sad.
Americans just think in automatic kind of categories. The word think doesn't apply. It's just reflexes. You know, it's just reflexes.
Now, you can imagine, and you probably have or have heard directly, what people might say when it's known that you left this country for those reasons, and now you're living in Mexico, which a lot of Americans would find is backwards and violent and all this kind of stuff, ironically so. Calling the kettle black is clear. But what is your experience there? How do you feel living in Mexico, and how do Mexicans view what's happening north of the border?
Yeah, good question. I mean, when Americans ask me, I mean, I moved down here in 2006, and when Americans ask me, do you have any regrets about moving to Mexico, I say only one, that I didn't do it 20 years earlier.
Mm-hmm.
The impression that you get of Mexico north of the border is a violent society, out of control, drug lords, people getting decapitated and all that sort of stuff. And a lot of that's true, but it's true for the northern states, that is to say the border states, and Michoacan, one interior state. It's not true of Mexico City. It's not true where I live, which is a few hours out. It's a, by and large, a very gracious, family-oriented, community-oriented kind of culture. I'll just give you one. Things like this happen to me two or three times a week, and they always stun me, and they wake me up to the fact that I am no longer living in the United States, thank God. And I'll just give you one example. So I live in this small town, but I also rent an apartment in Mexico City, and I divide my time between the two. And a couple of months ago, I was in Mexico City. I had been shopping. I'm coming. I live one flight up. I'm coming up the stairs. No elevators. I'm coming up the stairs with a couple of plastic bags of groceries, and one of the bags breaks. And so you have apples and jars of jam or whatever spilling out onto the stairs, making a racket. At the top of the stairs, there's an apartment. A door opens, and a girl of about 5 years old sticks her head out and sees what's going on. Without saying a word, she comes down the stairs, helps me collect all the stuff that got scattered around me, puts it back in the plastic bags, walks back up the stairs into her apartment and closes the door. Not a word is exchanged. The odds of that happening with a 5-year-old girl in the United States are roughly 1 in 10 billion. First, you know, little girls are taught that men are dangerous. You have right. to stay away from them. That's number one. Number two, they're also taught that if somebody, anybody in the United States is taught that if somebody is in distress, it's their problem. You don't go to their aid. And in fact, there are states now that have laws against feeding the homeless. You can go to jail for feeding the homeless in certain states. Yeah. You know, I mean, that is so grotesque from a Mexican point of view, I wouldn't even know where to begin. So that incident is an example of what it means to live in community. Mm-hmm. This is what this girl knew by age 5. All a kid, male or female, in the United States knows by age 5 is, it's a dangerous world, look out for yourself. I don't want to live in a society like that. Not for a moment. I mean, I enjoy going back to the United States and visiting my friends or giving a lecture or whatever it is. But when I slip back across the border, let me tell you, it's with a sense of relief.
There was an article in The Nation you might have seen by a woman, I can't remember her name, who was doing, I'm not sure if she was in the military or in a Peace Corps or something. She was doing work in Afghanistan to help rebuild stuff after we destroyed it. And then when her door duty, whatever it was over, she spent some time, I think, in Denmark or Norway. I don't remember which one of the Scandinavian countries, for like a year. And then she moved back to the United States. Again, I don't remember what part of the United States she lived in, but she moved back here. And then she wrote this essay comparing, saying how much more similar the United States was to Afghanistan than to Denmark or Norway.
Uh-huh.
That's the same kind of thing you're saying.
Yeah.
Before we wrap up, you mentioned quickly earlier your new novel, The Man Without Qualities.
Right.
It's fun. It is accessible way to explore the absurdity of life in the United States and what possibilities might exist. Can you just talk a little bit about the novel and what you hope readers get from it? I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, I enjoyed writing it. I mean, I wrote it actually very quickly. And the arc of the novel is the protagonist is this George Haskell. He's a retired professor of German lit, and he decides that to go completely horizontal, that basically the vertical life is not for him, and so he starts a dullness institute, an institute to promote dullness. As events take over him, the arc of the novel is that events multiply and they take over him, and by the end of the novel, he's threatening a coup d'etat against the United States government. So the subtitle might be From Walter Mitty to Lenin, you know? And I mean, I had a ball writing it, and the characters are very interesting, and, you know, I think it's quite funny. I think WBAI listeners, it's a good read. I think they'd enjoy it.
And it's interesting. I didn't think of it this way until you just mentioned it. Of course, I should have. I was just reading it. I was being in the moment, living authentically, and just reading it without trying to think too much about it and just let it happen to me. But trying to create dullness, was dullness in the sense of the way we in America, vertical livers, think dullness would be boring, which is actually the authentic, healthy way of living once you got to what that meant. And
I
just thought that was a brilliant, it catches you, it brings you into thinking one thing is going to happen, and you think you've read this before, I know this kind of story. Then you wind up going through it, and pretty quickly you realize this is something very different.
I just have to admit that it was a lot of fun to write, and you know, I get emails from people saying, you know, I had a good laugh from this.
You've written very different kinds of books. The two trilogies can't be that much more different in many ways in structure. And then you wrote this novel and other things I've seen you write. So you're pretty diverse compared to many of the guests we have on the show. So, I mean, I don't even know if I can pretend to write a novel. So I wish I could. It was very well liked by me, at least. So I recommend everybody listening to go out and find a copy of The Man Without Qualities. It's a trade paperback.
I also want to mention one other book I did, Barry. This was published about a year and a half ago. I did a study of Japan. It's called Neurotic Beauty, An Outsider Looks at Japan. And it's a kind of very dense cultural analysis of what that country is, especially in comparison to the United States.
But see, that is another example of your diversity.
Well, thank you.
Morris, for being on Equal Time for Free Thought. It's been great. Do you have another book project in mind?
You know, I've been busy trying to get things that are out of print back online, back on Amazon. One is a volume of poetry called Counting Blessings. The folks that published The Man Without Qualities, which is called the Oliver Arts and Open Press, they are bringing that volume of poetry back into print in July. And then I did another book, which was a kind of personal philosophical memoir, called Spinning Straw into Gold. And I'm working with the Water Street Press that did the Japan book, and hopefully within 2 or 3 months that'll be back on Amazon. So my time hasn't been terribly occupied with starting a new project, but with trying to do reparations on all the old stuff right now.
All right, sir. Have a good week, have a good summer, and we'll talk soon.
Sounds good, Barry. Thanks again.
You've been listening to a conversation with cultural historian and social critic Morris Berman. The key books of his we discussed today were Wandering God, The Man Without Qualities, and Why America Failed.